is what they think you're like, but I've heard the tender whisper of love in the dead of night, and you tell me that you're pleased and that I'm never alone. You're a good, good father.
Faith. We're dealing with this workbook here, and this morning we are just we won't get out of the introduction of that book. It is just really great workbook, that one. Only thing is, what I might do is put a line through the fasting area there. You know, that's a bit tough, isn't it? Amen. But anyway, it says in Song of Solomon 2:15, it says, take us the foxes, the little foxes, that spoil the vines, for our vines have tender grapes. You know, what we've been dealing with virtually over the last month or more is with the little things. And I kind of look at the little things are the things that we can and should do. All right, there are things that only God can do, but then there are things that we ourselves should do. And if we neglect doing those things, it will eventually lead to our ruin. Amen. You know, we can self-destroy. I mean, we can self-kill. Amen. So when we are born again, figuratively speaking, we start a race. Amen. And we start this race, and I do believe that each one of us, when God saved us, when we were born again, made new creatures in Christ, our intent was to finish well in Christ. Amen. We didn't, amen, get saved to lose our salvation. Amen. We started, we were born again, and that gave us entry into the race, and we aim to finish well. Amen. So that we, like Paul, might receive that crown of righteousness. I mean, that's the trophy that we're going for, amen? The same one that he got, amen? But the truth is that along the way, there are obstacles. It's an obstacle course. You know, there are trials we must face. There are temptations we must face. You know, there are circumstances that come against us, whether it be ill health, whether it be, something to do with, our finances, or, you know, things happen in our families, you know, all kinds of circumstances. You know, you might lose a job, I mean, that come against us. And some of those obstacles are beyond our own ability to do anything about. You know, some of those obstacles only God can get us through. Amen. Amen. But there are these little things that we can and we must do, that we must ensure we do not neglect, amen? If we want God to get us through the things that we cannot get through ourselves, well, then we must be faithful and do that which we can do, amen? You know, God can do the impossible things, but we must do the possible things, amen? But when it comes to these possible things that we should and must do, it's going to take discipline. And maybe that's why we're called disciples in the Bible. Mm. Amen. It'll challenge our time. It will challenge our priorities. It really comes down to what's really important, amen, in our lives, amen. But it is these little things that if we neglect them, they will bring certain ruin to our life. You know, some of the little things that we can take care of ourselves, if we'll set the time, if we'll discipline ourselves, if we'll prioritize them, there is Bible reading. We should not neglect Bible reading. We should not neglect Bible study. I mean, it's vitally important. I mean, it is vitally important that we have fellowship, and that we make sure we attend each of the meetings that we can. Because the Bible tells us to do that. You know, the Bible tells us that we should make disciples. You know, these are the things that we can do. The Bible tells us that we should serve. And again, that is something that we must decide to do ourselves. And then the Bible says that we must pray. Amen? Yes. You know, if we'll take care of the little things, God will take care of the big things. In fact, he makes us a promise in Isaiah 45 and verse 2, where he tells us he'll make the crooked path straight for us. Amen? And you can look at that in many ways. I don't know what kind of picture you get, but, you know, it's a bit like, you know, you can have a meandering river that seems to be going nowhere. Amen. But God can take that river and make it straight. You might be living, in your circumstance in your life currently where you feel like you're going nowhere. Men like go round and round in circles. I like that meandering river. Amen. But God can make things straight for you. Amen. He can get us there quicker. I love that. Amen. It says in Isaiah 45 and 2, I will go before you and make the crooked places straight. Isn't that wonderful? That God will go before us. And you know, I don't know about you, but I kind of believe in that everything should be line upon line, precept upon precept, here a little, there a little. A bit of the old and a bit of the new. Isn't that wonderful? Because that's what I believe that means. Here a little, there a little. Because Paul said this in 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 13. There have no temptation overtaken you, but such as is common to man. But God is faithful, who will not suffer you to be tempted above that you're able, but will with the temptation make a way of escape that you're able to bear it. Amen. Is it any wonder that we read in Revelation chapter, as a chapter 14, where the 144,000, you know, a symbol for the redeemed, follow the Lamb wherever he goes. Because he'll make the way straight for us. Amen. But you know what happens? That when we neglect the little things, it causes us to lose sight of Christ. See, that's the danger. When we neglect the little things, the little foxes, amen, it will cause us to lose sight of Christ. And of course, what happens when we lose sight of Christ, we become religious. We just, amen, invite in a religious spirit. But of course, we learned from last week that this religious spirit has but one aim, and that is firstly to steal your salvation, number two, to kill your spirit, and number three, to destroy your eternity.
Oh, yes, amen.
Would it be so sad to have run well for such a long time, amen, and then not quite make it to the finish line? Yeah. Man, how sad would that be? Amen. Now, one of my favorite verses is Jeremiah 29, verse 11. Jeremiah 29, verse 11, which tells me that God has a good plan for me, that God has a good plan for you. In fact, God has a good plan for every single human being. Amen. He says, for I know the thoughts that I think toward you. I tell you what. Amen. If God has thoughts toward you, that's a good thing. Amen. And I pray that I pray that good thoughts. Amen. Yeah. I think it's the literal says. It says, "I have plans, I have purposes for you." Amen. Saith the Lord, thoughts of peace and not evil, to give you an expected end. And I was just thinking about that last portion, to give you an expected end, not a certain end. Do you notice that? Not a certain end, but an expected end. God has an expected end for us. It's not enter the race and there's the finish line. Amen. The race must be won. Our faith in God must be tested. Amen. But brother, sister, if we will follow God's plan, his way, according to John 14, 6, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but through me. If we'll follow Jesus, then our end is assured. Amen? As simple as that. If we'll follow Jesus, our end is assured. Amen? To give you an expected end. And when you study that out, and when you study that verse, what it's saying is that God longs. You know what the word longs means? Longs for you and me to succeed. God is doing everything he can, amen, to help us to succeed. God is putting his all into us that we might win the race. God's not holding anything back. Amen. He is just doing his all to get us through. Amen. Jesus is on our side. It's like Paul said in the book of Romans, in his letter to the Romans. He said in Romans chapter 8, he said, if God be for us, who can be against us? If God be for me, who can be against me? And I gave that some thought. You know what I said? Me. Only me. Only me. I can be against myself. You can be against yourself. How? By neglecting the little things. It's as simple as that. Amen. You can destroy yourself. You can spiritually kill yourself by neglecting those little things. I love the Song of Solomon 2:15 in the Young's translation, because it kind of really hits home. It really hits home the urgency and the need and the disastrous outcome if we will neglect the foxes. It says, seize ye for us foxes, little foxes, destroyers of the vineyards. Amen? Even our sweet-smelling vineyards. I mean, these foxes just don't do a little damage. They destroy you. Amen? They will destroy you and me. So once again today, we open up our toolkit. I mean, aren't you glad you've got a toolkit? Amen? Isn't it wonderful? Amen. Our own set of tools. And of course, today, once again, we bring out the tool of prayer and faith. Prayer and faith. It's just a little tool that we must use and exercise. I mean, we must discipline ourselves to allocate time, to prioritize our time. Knowing that Paul said in the book of Thessalonians, his letter to the Thessalonians in chapter 5 of his first letter, he said, pray without ceasing. Pray without ceasing. And I don't know what you get from that verse, because obviously I don't think he meant that it's possible for us in the literal sense to be on your knees 24/7. But what I do get from that verse is a distinct impression that Paul had in mind urgency and the danger of neglect. Do you understand what I'm saying? That he didn't say, he wasn't saying that with a timid voice. It was an exhortation reminding us of the urgency of prayer and the danger or neglect of not praying. Amen. You see, probably the most defining verse dealing with prayer is found in the book of James, in James 5 and verse 16. If there is a verse in the Bible that explains prayer effectively, it is possibly this verse in James 5 and verse 16, which says, confess your faults one to another and pray for one another, or pray for another. I love that. Pray for another. There is no higher prayer than intercessory prayer.
Yeah.
When you selflessly give of yourself and your time for somebody else. Amen. That you may be healed. The effectual prayer of a righteous man or a woman availeth much. Now, when I looked this up in my Strongs, I found that the effectual fervent is one word. We use two words, or the English use two words for one word, and the Greek word is energio, from which I presume we get the word energy. Amen. So my understanding here is concerning prayer that firstly, prayer must be effectual.
Yeah.
What do we understand effectual to be?
have a good result.
Amen. That's it. It has to be result-based. Amen. Your prayer must have the capacity of producing or achieving a result. It's as simple as that. Don't pray nonsense. Your prayer, the one that God hears, is the one that is capable of achieving a result. It must be effectual. It must also have energy. So the way I see this, when I put the two together, it's telling me that our prayer, our words to God, must have a clear purpose with a desired result. Amen. And that when we have a clear purpose with a desired result in mind, there will be urgency or energy in our prayer. Amen. See, I don't think that God puts up with prayer that's lethargic, aims at nothing. It's 7 o'clock in the morning. It's time for me to pray. I don't think God puts up with that. You know, when you got, you know, part of your mind is on prayer, the other part of your mind's on what's long ahead for the day, and I better get this prayer over and done with the quickest possible so I can get into my day. I don't think God puts up with that. I don't think God hears that for 1 second. Man, our prayer must be effectual, fervent. I mean, we must pray for a defined purpose. There must be urgency and energy in our prayer. It's like Paul said concerning the race that he ran. He said, I therefore run not as uncertainty, but I fight as not beating the air. Amen. You know, I don't know about you, but you know, for example, all right, when it comes to praying over our meal. Who knows that sometimes that can just be a ritual? Well, God doesn't hear that, and our food is not blessed. There must be something deeper within us. We were truly thankful for what he has provided for us. But you see, the only way that we can be truly thankful that God has provided, amen, the steak or the broccoli or whatever it is that's on your plate, the sandwich on your plate, is you have to actually believe that God supplied that. Mm-hmm. And that it did not come by, amen, the sweat of your own brow. Does that make sense to you?
Yeah.
Amen, it really, and we'll deal with this as we kind of get into this a little bit this morning. You know, unless you have a true revelation that you're no longer your own, our prayer will just be beating the air. Amen. So our prayer must not only have the right words, but it must be thought out. It must be intended words with a certain purpose to hit the mark.
Yeah.
That's what biblical prayer is. You know, I was going to deal with it next week because as I went to sleep last night, I thought about this, is that when you look at the letter writing in the Bible, do you notice how it's always a pattern? There's the introduction, the content, and then the conclusion or the summary at the end, so to speak. And then when Jesus explained to his disciples about prayer in Matthew chapter 6, I think it is, but he also showed a pattern of prayer.
Yeah.
Amen. Where, amen, we worship God. Amen. We intercede, thy kingdom come. We bring our need and our faults and whatever else before God. And then we finish with, amen, for thine is the glory. Do you notice that? You see, I think we kind of, no wonder we live in this Laodicean time. Yeah, because you know, we've become email writers, text writers. And so we have lost the pattern to things. You can't just come before God and say, I want, I need, I want, I need, I want, I need. God doesn't put up with that. Amen. But that's how a lot of people, that's what their prayer life is. Amen. God, I want, and God, I need, and God, I'm in trouble, and God, give me this, and God, give me that, and God, God. Well, God's not interested in that. Amen. It's foolishness. The truth is that God's already told you that He'll give you what you need. True. There are some things you need not pray about, but rather seek the kingdom and His righteousness. True. Amen. So when it comes to this effectual prayer that is going to hit the mark, obviously you're going to have a clear vision or understanding of your purpose in God. And brother, sister, if you've not yet found that, you need to get before God and discover that. Amen. You've got to know what your life's about. Why you're here. Amen. What God's course for you is. Amen. And then as we discussed last week, the foundation of prayer are the promises of God. That's quite simple, isn't it? Amen. The foundation of prayer are the promises of God. You know, well, what's his name? George Mueller prayed because he knew the promises of God, that God would not leave the righteous forsaken and begging for bread. Amen. His prayer wasn't a wish. He was so confident that he had the table, the breakfast table, all laid out, waiting for the food to arrive at the door, because he knew the promises of God. Amen. So obviously then, Bible reading, Bible study are vital to be effective and energized in prayer. Amen. You cannot pray if you do not read and study your Bible. It's just nonsense. Amen. As I think we also said last week in 2 Timothy 2:15, right, study to show thyself approved. I tell you what, if you don't do the study part, you can pray until the cows come home, or the pig, is it the pig who jumps over the moon? Amen. God will not hear nothing. We're going to do our part. We're going to do our part. If we want God to do the impossible, we have to do the possible. And don't you worry about your time. When we are in God and operating according to His purposes, He'll make the crooked paths straight. You'll find you'll be wasting a lot less time on going round and round in circles, and much more time going directly for the mark. Does it make sense to you or not?
Yep.
Amen. Praise the Lord. Again, you know, James 5:16 in the Young's Literal Translation, it says this. It says, be confessing to one another the trespasses, and be praying for one another that you may be healed. Very strong is a working supplication of a righteous man. I love that. Very strong. I mean, again, this is energy. Can you get the picture? Energy.
Substance.
Yeah, when you know you're standing on holy ground, on righteous ground. Amen? And so we learned it from that last portion that the righteous person has strength. But notice how he starts the verse. Amen. That deals with confession of fault. You see, a righteous person is not faultless.
Amen.
Do you notice that?
Amen.
A righteous person is not faultless, is not faultless. However, that person is ready to confess his or her fault. A righteous person is simply somebody who is an open book.
Amen.
Before God and the church, or before God and the brothers and sisters. Mm-hmm. It is that person that has strength or power with God. We could say that in that person there is no guile.
Mm. Yeah.
Amen.
Everything's spoken of.
You know, it's like David, amen, who went boldly to the throne saying, "Search me, O Lord."
Yeah.
Amen. If you look at Hebrews chapter 4.
Mm.
Somebody read verse 13 of Hebrews chapter 4.
Neither is there any creature that is not manifest in his sight, but all things are naked and opened up unto the eyes of him with whom we have to do.
Well, brother, sister, man, what's the point in hiding your faults when God knows them?
Yeah.
Far better just coming into agreement with him and ask him to help you with those faults. Do you think?
Yeah.
Read verses 14 through 16.
Seeing then that we have a great high priest that has passed into the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold fast our profession. For we have not an high priest which cannot be touched with the feelings of our infirmities.
Isn't that wonderful?
Yeah.
God knows how we feel.
Mm-hmm.
God knows the struggles we go through.
Mm-hmm.
God knows our thoughts.
Yes.
Amen. God knows your weakness.
But was in all points tempted like as we are, yet without sin? Let us therefore come boldly unto the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need.
Amen.
Hey, brothers and sisters, the only thing that can dampen or destroy our energy in prayer is if we're hiding something.
Yeah.
Amen. The only thing that would not equip us to hit the mark is if we are hiding something. If we can't come boldly to the throne of grace. See, again, it just reminds me that God's not into this timid nonsense. Amen? God's not into baby stuff.
No.
God's not into wimpy nonsense. He's the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Amen? Come to him in certainty. Bring your certain needs before him. Amen? But do so as an open book. That's the important part. Amen? So what is prayer?
Communion with God.
It's just a conversation with God, isn't it? Yeah. Really, when you think about it.
Yes.
Amen? It's how we interact with God. To not only know him, but also we allow God to have a tangible and direct influence in our own lives.
Yeah.
Because that's important. It's not just about knowing God. It's also through prayer we allow him to take the reins of our own lives and influence our own life. Amen. You see, it's one thing to read your Bible. And certainly through reading your Bible, you can get a good understanding of the character and nature of God. But surely it is something far greater when the owner and author of the Bible converses directly with you.
Yeah.
Wouldn't that be wonderful?
Mm.
Yeah, it's probably one, it'd be one thing to read, I mean, the biography of a famous person.
And to have him with you.
Amen. And having the opportunity to sit down with that person for a few minutes face to face. What would you get more from? Amen. Reading the book or speaking with the author?
Yeah.
face to face, so you can begin to gauge the intent and the thoughts behind some of the words on the pages. Amen. In comparison, if you look at Psalm 119, somebody go to Psalm 17. Somebody else, Psalm 119, and read verses 116 and 117.
What was the first one, Gil?
Psalm 119, verse 116 and 117. Big numbers.
Uphold me.
Go on. Yeah. Okay.
Uphold me according to thy word, that I may live, and let me not be ashamed of my hope. Hold thou me up, and I shall be safe. And I will have respect unto thy statutes continually.
So there I kind of get the impression that he's getting revelation from reading the word. But then when you go to Psalm 17 and read verses 5 through 8.
Hold up my goings in thy paths, that my footsteps slip not. I have called upon thee, for thou wilt hear me.
To me now he is on a different level, personally interacting. He's come boldly to the throne of grace.
Incline thine ear unto me and hear my speech. Shew thy marvellous loving kindness, O thou that savest by the right hand them which put their trust in thee from those that rise up against them. Keep me as the apple of thy eye. Hide me under the shadow of thy wings.
Amen. Amen. Hey, do you understand that he didn't mention the word or the scriptures or the commandments once? Or the statutes once?
All about him being with you. Amen.
Amen. But yet he's aiming for something. And he does so boldly, urgently, and energized because he knows God. He knows that God is loving kindness. Amen. He knows that God is love. Amen. Praise the Lord. You see, I think that one of the most difficult truths in the Bible in our day to not only understand but to have revealed to our hearts is that we are no longer our own. I believe, well, if you read the account of the Church of the Laodicean, the age that we, I believe, living in, amen, the seventh trumpet time, the seventh seal time, is that it is the stronghold of that church in that they cannot seem to understand or have it in their hearts that without God, they can do nothing and are nothing.
Amen.
You see, it is difficult to comprehend in our day that the steps of a good man are ordered. The steps of a righteous man are ordered or directed by the Lord. When on face value, let's be honest, we seem quite capable to do what needs to be done without God. Amen? We can manage fine without God. We've all got jobs, businesses, whatever, income from somewhere. We don't have to pray for our meal. We know it'll be there. Ours arrives every Tuesday, you know, just before lunchtime. Amen? It's there every single Tuesday. You kind of know what I mean.
Yeah.
You see, there is an area, in fact, this really is an area in our life that we cannot hide from. And maybe one of the reasons why we don't pray always. Amen. If you go to Proverbs chapter 20, maybe it's because we think or have it in our mind set that we can take care of things ourselves, or we can do things by the exercise of our own hands. But you see, Proverbs 20 and 24 says this: man's goings are of the Lord. How can a man then understand his own way? And that's a question. There's a question mark behind that. Amen. And then, as I'm not sure if Sister Anne mentioned Jeremiah 10 and 23, or was it Trevor? Somebody did. Oh, Lord, I know. Jeremiah knew, but do I know? Lord, I know the way of man is not in himself. It's not in a man that walketh to direct his own steps. Jeremiah knew that, but do I know that? Do you know that? Amen. And I'm talking about not knowing it in your head, but in your heart.
Amen.
Because remember that life flows not from your head. It comes from your heart. Every single person leads their life not from their head, but from their hearts. As, again, the book of Proverbs tells us in chapter 4, keep thy heart with all diligence, for out of it are the issues of life. So until we settle our ownership, amen, and settle it not in our heads but in our hearts, we're always going to struggle. We'll always have those little holes in the wall that will allow the little foxes into our lives. You know, David prayed again, hold my goings in your path, God, that my feet do not slip. Amen. It is not possible for you and me to direct our own path. It's not possible for you and me to make good choices. Amen. Without being in harmony with God. You were born again because you came into harmony with God. It was God's will and purpose for you to be saved. Amen. And you lined up. You lined your choice up with that promise. Amen. With that will, if you like. Amen. It is only as we commune with God will God give us the wisdom to make good choices. Isn't that true?
Yes. Amen.
You see, you can say, and listen, I don't want to take anything away from your Bible, but your Bible is one thing. Communing with God is on a different level. I mean, certainly from the Bible, you can, get the definition of what's right and wrong. But you know what? A lot of people, knowing the right, still do the wrong. Some of us probably do that or have done that. Amen. Whether it be in our lives, whether it be at our work or in our businesses. But you see, things go to a different level. Amen. When we begin to seek God and seek his wisdom. It's like we become more comfortable in making the more difficult decisions. Again, we go to the book of James. Because, again, the wonderful thing is this. God doesn't want you to make hard choices on your own. But he says, I will give you wisdom. He offers it to us freely, as much as you want. As much as you want. Amen. In James 1:5, it says, if any of you lack wisdom, let him ask of God, who giveth all men liberally, and it doesn't hold anything back, and it shall be given him. No wonder, hey man, one of the names of God is what? El Shaddai. The Lord God Almighty. And you can, I mean, see that any way you like, but hey, let me put it this way. He never runs out. Amen. He never, and the shelf is always stocked. Amen. When you go and get wisdom, it will be there.
Yeah.
When you need your need met, it will be there.
Mm.
Amen. Whatever your struggle, your circumstance is, the answer is on the shelf. God does not run out.
Amen.
God is never sitting there puzzled, or how am I going to fix this? God knows the end from the beginning. Just get into his plan. Amen?
Yeah.
He is the Lord God Almighty. He's too much. Amen? Mm. You know, a clear sign that one's path is misaligned with God's path is suffering from any one of these conditions: worry, fretting, anxiousness, anxiety, sleeplessness. They are sure signs that God's path and God's purpose and your path and your purpose are kind of misaligned.
Oh,
yikes. Amen.
I'm doomed. I think God wants me to go on the dole.
I reckon he wants me to go on holiday.
Why not get away from what God thinks, or what you think God thinks, and get to a place of certainly knowing what God actually says? But you see, there's a step that you must take first, and it's a very easy one. It's found in Psalm 55 and 22. God, we can all suffer from anxiety. We can all suffer from fretting. We can all get worried. We can all be anxious. But God says you don't have to put up with it. That's what God says. He didn't make you to put up with that junk. Because all those conditions deal with tomorrow. The reason why people can't sleep at night is because they're worried about tomorrow. What's going to happen tomorrow? We're going down tomorrow. The business is going to be shuttered tomorrow. The money won't be in the bank tomorrow. I'm going to die tomorrow. There'll be, hey, HelloFresh is not coming this Tuesday. What are we going to do? They should pay me a little fee for mentioning their name.
I reckon.
But Psalm 55, 22 says, cast thy burden upon the Lord. Don't walk one more second. Why would you? As I said, prayer stands on one thing only: the promises of God. Not wish so, hope so, think so. The promises of God. And God says, cast your burden upon me. As David said, I think it's David, cast the burden upon the Lord and he shall sustain thee. Mm-hmm. He shall never suffer the righteous to be moved. Amen. Now, of course, remember righteous there. That's that open book person. Remember that? That's the open book person. Hey, but notice what this verse is telling us. Don't hand it over gently. Don't push it towards God. That's not what it says. It says to throw it, to hurl it, to cast it from you, to see it as something vile and poison.
Amen.
Amen. Something that I don't know, there's probably some things that if I got you to hold, some slippery, slimy thing, you'd just throw it away. Amen. If I put a snake in Trevor's hand, he would cast it away. Maybe I put a mouse in somebody's hand, I'll turf it away. And that's what this verse here is saying. Don't mull over, don't meditate over the problems.
Amen.
That's not what it says. Don't hum and ha and baby the burden. It says there, cast it away, hurl it away, throw it away. Throw it towards God.
Amen.
Don't keep burdens in, let them out.
Yeah.
That's what this verse is telling us. Prayer rests on the promises of God. Isn't that true?
Yeah.
Don't go 1 minute longer with a burden. Amen. Hand them over, give them, cast them upon the Lord.
Amen.
But how are you going to do that? You can't physically do it.
No, by faith you've got to be
able to. You've got to do it by prayer.
Yeah,
the effectual, fervent prayer of a righteous person. Don't be timid, but with energy and purpose.
Yeah.
Amen? Notice the second part. Not suffer the righteous to be moved.
Amen.
He's talking about those who are the open book. Isn't that right?
Yeah.
You see, again, remember, you know, precept upon precept, line upon line, here a little bit, there a little bit. Amen. Again, a little bit of the old, a little bit of the new. So we go over to the New Testament and Paul tells us to do the same exact thing. He says, be careful for nothing. The Young's translation says, for nothing be anxious, but in everything, by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving. Notice, it's not just rush to God, I need, I want. There is a pattern to this. You're coming before the King of Kings. It's not the mate across the fence. Do you understand what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Amen. This is the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, the one who has the reins of our lives.
Amen.
We don't need to be in a hurry. We can spend time to thank him. We can spend time to worship him.
Amen.
It says, let your requests be known unto God, for nothing be anxious. How much is nothing?
Nothing, everything.
There is nothing too difficult for God.
Amen. Yeah, like,
but the key is prayer.
Amen.
And everything by prayer.
Thanksgiving.
Communicating with God.
Amen.
But not as speaking to a mate.
No.
But as speaking to the King of Kings and Lord of Lords.
Amen.
And he expects us, as we come boldly to the throne, to come a certain way. Energized.
Yes.
Righteous.
Amen.
Respectful.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Even down to this morning when Philip got up and he's rambling and telling me everything he's got to do today. If beforehand I would get really chewed up about it, thinking, you know, oh, he could become the church, whatever, whatever. But I said, I just silently myself said, Lord, I'm not going to let his decisions bother me. And it was like I walked away from it easily with a peace, you know what I'm saying? And it just makes all the difference. And, you know, you've got to grow in that and believe that that's what God wants for you.
Amen.
And that's what I did this morning. I come away with it without even it affecting me. And it's amazing. God can do it for you.
Amen. If there's probably one verse to sum up this morning, it would be 1 Samuel 2 and verse 9.
Nice.
1 Samuel 2 and verse 9. It says, he will keep the feet of his saints.
Yeah.
The wicked shall be silent in darkness, for by strength shall no man prevail. If you think you can make it your way, you're in for a shock. If you think you can make your own plan day by day, you're in for a shock. But the promise is, again, the promise, he will keep the feet of his saints. Do you know that, as we finish, do you know that Paul and Silas found themselves in prison one day? Who remembers that?
Yeah.
Do you know, I found myself in prison one day. I think Brother Tim was with us.
Yeah, he was.
I tell you what, I was anxious. But you know what, Paul and Silas, they simply sang songs and prayed to God.
Amen.
You know, Peter, he was so anxious about being put in prison, he fell asleep.
Amazing, isn't it?
Brother, sister, purpose today. Let's have another challenge this week. All right, and if you're not quite got on top of last week's challenge, you know, a good place to start, put it on top of your calendar each day. I will plan my day with God. Amen. Just put it there. Amen. But our challenge this week is, when you feel burdened, cast it away. When you feel anxious, don't mull over it. Don't pat it. Amen. I think that's what we do sometimes. Don't pat it. Amen. Don't cuddle it. But see it as deadly poison and cast it away.
Amen.
How? On your knees, figuratively speaking, speaking with God.
Spiritually connected.
And then I would not be surprised if you feel something lift from you. Because most things that we're concerned and are worried about are things that are out of our control anyway.
Yeah. Amen.
Any wonder that Jesus said, as we finish in Matthew chapter 11 and verse 20, he said, come unto me. Well, the only way you can come to Jesus is prayer. There is no other way. He's not walking down the street. Amen. You won't find him in Nazareth. You won't find him at the Sea of Galilee. I mean, he's not there. He's not in the tomb either, I heard the song say this morning. Amen. You've got to come to him in prayer. All ye that labor and are heavy laden. Is this speaking to anybody? And I will give you rest. But the precondition is, I've got to come to him. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am meek, lowly in heart, and you shall find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light.
Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hey, I'm going to stop there, but maybe next week, if we get an opportunity, because I'm sure we've all prayed from time to time, and we have felt we've not heard or had God answer our prayer. And how do we deal with that? You know, even, you know, you seem righteous and you believe that you're praying in the will of God, but yet it is like, it's not just not getting your petition, you feel like God has not even heard or answered your petition. Does that make sense? We've probably all suffered from that at some time in our Christian walk. And, of course, if you don't understand what is taking place, it can become faith-destroying. And so I think that would be a good area maybe for us to look at next week. Of course, the week after that, we're going to have fellowship together here at my house, I think. Amen. Praise the Lord. Hey, so you want to add anything? I hope this morning's been a help to you. If it's just Hey, anxiety, worry, and all that, that's poison.
Amen.
It's poison. Don't mull over it. Don't chew over it. Don't be like a cow and chew the cud. I think that's sometimes how we are. Because you know what? If you hang on to worry and anxiety, it starts becoming your excuse. And you become addicted to it. In fact, no, you can get to a point, I think some people, their lives are not lived unless they're on the edge of anxiety and worry.
Mm.
That's not life.
Yeah, you get that used to
That's
it.
Bondage and slavery. Jesus didn't come to give us that kind of life. He didn't come to you to give you that kind of life. He came to give you life abundantly.
Yeah.
Amen? And by that, I mean well-being.
Amen.
He came to give you a peace that would pass all understanding. In other words, a peace that is beyond the comprehension of mankind.
Yeah.
Now, when everyone else is saying the ship's going down, you're saying, no, everything will be fine.
Yeah.
I mean, you're the crazy one.
Yeah,
amen. When everyone else is dying of strokes and heart attacks and high blood pressures and blah, blah, blah. And of course, you know, we all, as we get older, obviously we do suffer a bit health and our health wise. But you know what I mean? There are young people.
Yes, there are. Yeah, I know.
So I'm talking about it because they just wreck themselves with worry and achieving and just achieving God. It's easier. Take my yoke upon you. Learn of me. How are you going to learn of him? Maybe a bit of Bible reading and Bible study might help, do you think?
Yeah.
Amen. Anyway, I better stop there before I get myself in trouble.